Hi guys, so we've been looking at the Monte Carlo method. We have seen a few examples of how this works out in practice, right? So these discussions have been sort of very strongly example based and implementation based. We have not really gone into the theory of the Monte Carlo method or why it works and so on. The theoretical aspects would require a substantially more involved discussion and would involve more time and so on. Anyway, that's not really the goal of this course. So in the same spirit, we will continue with some more examples. So one more example which I will discuss in this particular module is that of computing pi by an alternate method. We already saw one method of computing pi using an integral and using important sampling. Now, the method that I'm going to describe here is related to something called the Buffon's needle drop experiment. So this is a centuries old problem which was considered by this person called Buffon, and so who imagined dropping a lot of pins. And so you imagine a sheet of paper which has lots of parallel lines. It could be, you know, your ruled notebook, for example, and then you drop pins of a certain length. And then you ask, what is the probability that, you know, this pin would cross a line, and what is the probability that it does not cross a line, right? So one has to take care of, you know, the various angles present and so on. And it's possible to do a probability calculation of this and find out the answer. And it turns out that this answer is also actually related to pi. And so, in fact, there is a way to compute pi using, you know, doing this kind of a needle drop experiment repeatedly. You can drop like a million pins on top of a piece of paper with lots of lines. And I mean, the calculation is somewhat involved, and you have to consider cases whether the, you know, the distance between the lines is greater or lesser than the length of the pin involved and so on. Right. So the method I'm going to describe today to compute pi is rather simple, and it illustrates the philosophy of the Monte Carlo method. So here we go. Okay, so the idea is to consider a region which is you know, a circle of radius 1, and there is a square that encloses this circle. And so you just imagine you know, dropping this kind of you're doing a needle drop experiment of Buffon or somebody else. You can imagine that there is a flat surface which you know, which has this kind of a circle of unit radius, and there is a square around it which will have length 2, because the diameter of the circle is 2. And then you imagine dropping lots of darts, or, you know, if it would be darts if it is vertical, but I guess it makes more sense to think of this as a plane on the ground, and then you're dropping lots of needles from above, right? And then you just simply count the number of needles which fall inside the circle and evaluate the ratio of the number of needles which fall inside the circle to the total number of needles dropped. And of course, the key requirement here is that it's going to be a uniform distribution. So every point inside this square of unit side 2 is equally likely. So there is no bias for these needles. They can be dropped. They are dropped you know, everywhere with the same probability. Right? If this happens, then indeed it's our Monte Carlo theory tells us that this number of points, the ratio of the number of points which have dropped inside the circle divided by the total number of pins which are dropped is going to be basically the area of the circle divided by the total area, which you will see immediately will give us an estimate of pi. So how does this go about? So probability of this falling inside the circle is pi times radius squared, which is just 1, divided by area of the square, which is 4, right? Because you have a square whose each side is 2. in whatever units. So it's going to be pi by 4. Now, in practice, using the fourfold symmetry of the problem, we can actually solve this problem by considering just the first quadrant. You don't have to, so what we are planning to do is, of course, do this computationally. It's just impractical to actually drop so many pins, Buffon experiment style. But we have a pseudo random number generator, right? With us, we have Mathematica, and then we can use this to generate lots of random numbers as long as they're drawn from a uniform distribution in the appropriate manner. We can actually get a very good estimate of pi by this method. So since you can get pi by 4, you can also get pi. And so to do this, we will just consider one quadrant of this circle and then perform an experiment only inside this and ask what will be the. So it's going to be just so the area of this small square now is what? It's going to be 1 square. So then the area of this circular arc, this 1/4 of the circle is just pi by 4. Right, so it's exactly the same. So you still have to multiply by 4 in the end. Okay, so here is the code which does this. There's a compact way of doing this whole thing, and that is, so as always with Mathematica, you just try to create a table of tables. So like that's what we do here. So you say that let's go inwards out. So if I generate random real, I told you that random real for me will get me a random number between 0 and 1. So let me look at input here, and then I have random real. If I do it once, it gives me a random number between 0 and 1. So I can, so I can do this in any interval. So I can specify it like here. So I can look at what this does if I make a table of this. So a table of random real, and let's say I generate 100 of these, and let me make a histogram of this. So it's giving me a uniform distribution between 0 and 1. Right, in this interval. So actually what I want to do is generate, you know, two such numbers instead of, yeah, so equivalently I could have also done it like this. So I can actually do so it gives me 100 numbers. So instead of what I do is I get two such numbers. So why do I need to do two and square it? If I take two such numbers, it's along the x and along the y. So I remember I'm in the first quadrant. So the x value will go from 0 to 1 and the y value will go from 0 to 1. So I'll generate two such random numbers and then I will just square it. If I square it, what does it mean? It means I'm finding x squared plus y squared, right? I'm finding x squared and y squared, and then I will total it, right? I can always do this. Then I can total it. Total will just give me a single number. So basically, that is, if I find a point which is for x is somewhere here and y is somewhere here, it's a point like this, and the distance from the origin is distance squared is just given by x squared plus y squared, and that's what I'm doing. So this number clearly can go all the way up to 1 plus 1, that's the maximum. So then you would be somewhere here. So you ask how many of these points that I generate will lie inside the inside this quadrant of the circle, and clearly that will happen whenever this distance is less than or equal to 1, right? So what I can do is I can say if random real total this distance is this entire thing, I should put it and close it in these kind of brackets. If it is less than or equal to 1, if it is less than or equal to, so that's so you can get the syntax for this using palettes and basic math assistant, and you can go to these commands here and search around. So there you go. So you have less than or equal to. There are of course shortcuts as well, but you can also do this less than or equal to 1, less than or equal to, if this is less than or equal to 1, then you want the answer 1, and if it is not less than or equal to 1, then you want to get a 0. So let's see. So it gives me a 0 once. This random number was, most of the times it's going to give me 1 because it's more likely, but of course from time to time you'll get a 0, and so that's the whole point. So you can keep on doing this many, many times, and that's what is done here. So you make a table of this and do it n max times, and then you count the total. If you sum all this array, it tells you the total number of ones there, right? And that's all you want really. And times 4, because ultimately what do you want? You have to multiply by 4. We are interested in pi, so I will multiply by 4, and then I have to divide by total number of attempts, which is just n max. And that's it. So that will create for me another table. I want to generate a large number of these, and I will call that data set. So let me do this. So let me get rid of this math assistant. So now I have this whole thing. Timing is just done to keep track of how much time it takes. Yeah, so it is evaluating. May take a minute. Yes, there you go. So the answer is out there, and so you see that it's a histogram, and I have a data set with lots of numbers which are, you know, crowded around this 3.14, right? So not only have I you know, just got an estimate of this. But it also gives me a histogram in the end, right? So, so it tells us how accurately we have determined the value of pi using the Monte Carlo method, right? So let's actually take a look at what this data set looks like. It has a large number of quantities. Let me just reduce this number. Just when you want to get a feeling for what is going on here, we can actually start with, let's say, just 100 such numbers. And let me evaluate this. If I do it, then of course it's a little bit more skewed, and so it's giving me, so let's say table form. If I do table form, I can go ahead and make this input, and I'll say table form of data set. So there you see, you got a whole bunch of numbers which are all in the ballpark of, you know, 3.14. So I can just simply take an average of all this. Let's take, let me just take a mean of this instead of table form. Let me take the mean of this, and mean is indeed very close to the value of pi that we all already know. So I want you to go back and, you know, take this piece of code and work this out for yourself, right? So timing is also put in here, and you can play this game and see how good this value is. For example, you can make a plot of, you know, the mean of this quantity as a function of n max. So with just 100, I'm already getting a very good value. Let me see what happens if I have 1000. If I have 1000, and then if I do mean of this data set, then it's around the same ballpark. So this is a game that you can play, and you can actually do very sophisticated things. You can find error bars, you can find out how the convergence is, you can play with, you know, there are two quantities involved here. One is this n max, right? And the other one is, so you can use, so many pins are getting dropped, right? So, and you can find error bars using, you know, a spread around the mean value using the histogram and so on, right? You can do more sophisticated approaches. And another useful task would be to compare the results of this method versus, you know, that obtained from the importance sampling method using the integral, right? And ultimately they are all sort of similar in flavor, and so you might expect that the computational labor involved and the accuracy that comes out will be sort of comparable, but it's a worthy exercise to try out. Okay, so that's what this small module is about, is yet another example of the Monte Carlo method to compute pi. Thank you.